women in marriage?
I do.
Except the Lord builded the house, the labor in vain that build it. Let us sing the first hymn under the hymn sheet, O perfect love of human thought transcending. Help us in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. We are gathered here in the presence of God and in face of this congregation to join together in marriage this man and this woman. Marriage is a holy estate instituted by God and hallowed by our Lord's gracious presence at the marriage in Cana of Galilee. It is commended in Holy Scripture as honourable in all and consecrated as signifying the mystical union between Christ and his church. It is therefore not to be entered upon lightly or unadvisedly, but thoughtfully, reverently, and in the fear of God, with the due consideration of the ends for which it was ordained. It was ordained for a lifelong companionship, help and comfort, which husband and wife ought to have of each other. It was ordained for the continuance of the holy ordinance of family life, that children who are the heritage of the Lord should be duly nurtured and trained up in godliness. It was ordained for the welfare of human society, which can be strong and happy only where the marriage bond is held in honour. Into this holy estate these two now desire to enter. Therefore, if anyone can show any just cause why they may not lawfully be joined together in marriage, let them now declare it. Also, I require and charge you both that you shall answer at the day of judgment, that if either of you know any just cause, while you may not lawfully be joined together in marriage, you do now confess it. For as much as no one speaketh, let us ask for the blessing of God on the union now to be formed. Let us pray. Almighty and most merciful Father, we praise you for all the bounties of your providence and for all the gifts of your grace. Especially at this time, we thank you for the institution of marriage, which you have ordained it to guard, to help, and to perfect the sacred gift of love. We thank you for the joy which these and your servants have found in one another, and for the love and trust into which they enter this holy estate. And since without your help we cannot do anything as we ought, we pray that you will enrich these your servants here before you with your grace, that they may enter into the marriage covenant as in your sight, and to truly keep the vows that they are about to make, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Can the congregation please be upstanding? As a seal to the vows you are about to make, give each other the right hand. Repeat after me, please, Iain. I, Iain. To take thee, Vivien.
To take thee, Vivien.
To be my wedded wife.
To be my wedded wife.
And do.
And do.
In the presence of God.
In the presence of God.
And before this congregation.
And before this congregation.
Promise and covenant.
Promise and covenant.
To be a loving.
To be a loving.
Faithful.
Faithful.
And a dutiful husband.
And a dutiful husband.
Unto thee.
Unto thee.
Until God shall separate us by death.
Until God shall separate us by death.
Repeat after me, please, for me. I, Vivien. To take thee, Iain. To be my wedded husband.
To be my wedded husband.
And to do.
In the presence of God.
And before this congregation.
And before this congregation.
Promise and the covenant.
Promise and covenant.
To be a loving.
Faithful.
And a dutiful wife.
And a dutiful wife.
Unto thee.
Until God shall separate us by death.
As a token of the covenant into which you have entered, these rings are given and are received. By this sign you take each other to have and to hold from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish, till death do you part. For as much as you have covenanted together in holy wedlock, and have declared it the same before God and these witnesses, I pronounce you to be husband and wife, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. What God has joined together, let no one put asunder. God of the Father, God of the Son, God of the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve and keep you. The Lord pour out the riches of his grace upon you, that you may please him and live together in holy love until your life's end. Amen. Now the Lord bless you and keep you.
Thank you.
Please sit. Please sit down.
The duty which the estate of marriage chiefly imposes is mutual love and reverence between man and wife. And this duty is plainly set forth in God's holy word, where we read. Love is patient, love is kind, and envies no one. Love is never selfish, not conceited, nor rude, not quick to take offence. Love keeps no score of wrongs, does not gloat over other people's sins, but it delights in the truth. There is nothing love cannot face, there is no limit to its faith, its hope, and its endurance. Love will never come to an end. In a word, there are three things that last forever: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of them all is love. Jesus himself said, "As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Continue in my love. If you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These words have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." Take this book, and upon its wisdom, build it your home. Iain and Vivien, if you can take some words of advice from someone who has been married for 29 years, this is the simple advice I would pass on to you. First of all, Iain, I would say to you, always, always during your married life, look upon Vivien here as being your extra special girlfriend in life. And of course, Vivien, I say to you, always, always during your married life, look upon Iain here as being your extra special boyfriend in life. In other words, I'm saying, don't stop courting just because you are married, and never ever take one another for granted. If you follow that simple advice, more especially if you remember God's holy word read on this your special day, about God's love, Christ's love, Christian love, then your married life will indeed be a blessed one and a happy one. Let us pray. O Lord, our God, the author and giver of all things, who has consecrated this estate of marriage and made it holy, cause your blessing to descend and rest upon your servants who have been joined together in your name. Grant that they may dwell in unity and love all of the days of their life, seeking one another's welfare, bearing one another's burdens, sharing one another's joys. Fill their dwelling with good things, that they may have for the supply of their own wants, and for the relief of them that need it. Above all, O most merciful Father, we pray you to enrich their souls with your heavenly grace, that they may obey and serve you all of their days, and that at the last be made partakers of your eternal kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The second hymn under the hymn sheet, God of all living, Father, we praise you.
Thank you.
which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you, now and always. Amen.
Thank you. that was a fly move. You went the wrong way. You know, your fault, man.
Thank you. Standing in order to receive the bride and the bridegroom, who will now cut the cake. Thank you.
I joined them for the Vivien and Iain. We can see if your father yet porridge this morning. Ladies and gentlemen, I realise that I had said at the young garden here, as I've always said after a wedding feast, if only I could get an easy chair and have 40 winks. I'm sure you feel the very same as I do just now. So this is why you're getting late call just now. Have your 40 winks. But it's always a great joy and pleasure for a minister to be asked by a young lady, would you agree to marry me? And especially when the young lady was Vivien coming along 18 months ago, 2 years almost, asking if I would marry her. And I knew too well that she didn't really want to marry me, but they started being there with her. And it's amazing how the time has gone past until we have arrived at this most happy day. A happy day for me as Minister Vivien, because I've come to know you and your family very well indeed. And of course, it goes the other way too, that you've come to know me very well indeed, Vivien, you and your family. And it's amazing the patience you've shown these last 8 years. I remember coming into the house in my early days, and when Vivien was still a student, working in the bank, and I would be offered coffee. Anne's coffee was good. Jim's coffee was even better. And then Gordon would say, would you like something to eat? Vivien made it, and he would make a face, but I've survived, Vivien, I've survived. But there's a story told about the young girl who came home from the dancing this night. And her father said, I've had Jock Thompson at the door asking for your hand in marriage. And the wee girl started crying and said, but Dad, I don't want to leave my mum, I don't want to leave my mum. Dad says, that's okay, you can take your mum with you, you can take your mum with you. Ladies and gentlemen, to our first speaker today, a very, very quiet man. When he's in his house, he harnesses a word. He never gets a chance, at least he's never had a chance up till now with Vivien there and Anne, his wife there. But now, Jim, you can stand on your feet and say exactly what you want.
Ladies and gentlemen, first of all, may I extend a very warm and sincere welcome to each and every one of you here this afternoon. I thank you on behalf of Anne and myself for accepting our invitation, for coming along, first of all, to Berry Old Parish Church, where I'm sure you'd agree we witnessed a lovely wedding ceremony, and thereafter down here to the Enshire Grange Hotel in Pullman to help us celebrate this very happy event, the marriage of Vivien and Iain. Now, naturally, the two most important people here today are, of course, the bride and the groom. But this is also a very special day for Anne and myself and for Sheena and Dougie. This being the first wedding we've had in either of our two families, and may I say we're delighted to be associated and joined together in this way. Those of you who know me, I think will agree that I try at least to be young at heart, if you think along these lines. But all of a sudden today, I seem to realise that, to say the least, I must be getting on a bit. Those of you in the assembled company who have previously been father of the bride, I'm sure you'll agree with me that as well as being a very proud moment, it's also a very emotional moment, and a moment which really does make you sit up and think. When I realise that that beautiful young lady in my arm today walking down the aisle looking radiant, bedecked in all her finery, her lovely wedding dress, etc., was my wee girl. And it really makes you very proud and very humble indeed. And it makes me realise that it's nearly 29 years ago since Mr. Joe Murray did me the honour of escorting his lovely young daughter Anne down the aisle to marry me. And I can assure you folks that Anne looked as beautiful on that day as Vivien does today, and I'm proud of them both. Still looks as lovely today, especially. Now, recently my attention was drawn to a fact which, when I tell you what it is, I think you'll say it's like a coincidence, but it's not really. The fact being that 10 years ago this month, in July 1981, Princess Diana married Prince Charles. 5 years later, once in July 1986, Fergie, who became a duchess, not a princess, married Prince Andrew. And lo and behold, today in July 1991, my little princess has married her Prince Charming. Now, when I tried to think what I could say about Vivien, and of course about Iain as well, I thought back to when I was a young lad. And at that time, I used to derive a lot of pleasure from making up small poems or bits of poetry. So what I did was gather together one or two facts from the past and from the present and attempted to put them into poetic form. Now, I don't claim to be any Wordsworth or Keats or even Robbie Burns for that matter, so please excuse me if the lines don't rhyme quite correctly or scan properly, but I put pen to paper and here's what I come up with. You're all right. I'm sure Vivien sitting here absolutely petrified. She doesn't know anything about this. What the earth is going to say about it? I can assure her she has nothing to worry about. Perhaps Iain has, but she When Vivien was a little girl, she had a teddy bear. She had lots of dolls and cuddly toys and lovely curly hair. A nice, attractive, pretty girl, always dressed for the occasion. She even went to Butland. A contented wee lass, she always was, making tea and scones, and having nice wee parties, chatting to imaginary friends. One day when she was playing, her mum thought she would kick, and found her in a wendy house, lying fast asleep. When she was 5, she went to school. That was a big occasion. In her blazer and school uniform, she was the height of fashion. One day when she walked down to school, she ran home, rather scared, and tried to tell her mummy that the footbridge had disappeared. She decided to join the brownies, then on to the guides she went. She earned many badges. One from the Queen was sent, one time at Carol, she was the chef, and she tried to convince her mum and me that she had taken 5 minutes to cook the mince. As Vivien grew up, she still did play with games and cuddly toys, but gradually she became interested in real, live, living boys. When to the disco she'd go with Susan and with Lynn, I think they had a competition to see just who would win. When they came home at 1 a.m, sometimes giggly and quite merry. Either they had enjoyed the dance or been drinking too much sherry. The boys she had, there were a few. Their names I will not mention. But as each one disappeared, Vivien had but one intention. That was to wait for Mr. Wright. But we found it quite alarming, until at last we realised she was waiting for Prince Charming. Having worked for 5 years in the bank in Derry, Stirling and Carlisle, Vivien decided to go to college to study for a while. To be a primary teacher was her number one intention, and we did all look forward to and enjoyed her recent graduation. When Vivien's mum was badly hurt, to hospital she went. 10 weeks in the intensive care in Edinburgh Royal she spent. Vivien was a little cook and baker and chambermaid, and with wee brother Gordon looked after their old dad. And when at last Vivien's mum got home, there was great celebration, and we are all delighted she's here to join this great occasion. And then, along came Ian Gillis, and Lindsay he did stay. They met at Justine's party in a loving sort of way. When Ian came to visit us, all suave and debonair, white shirt, tie and blazer, and neatly combed red hair. He was a proper gentleman. His manners were very good. The road from Lindsay to Denny was regularly used. And when he had visited us once or twice, I achieved one of my wishes, because I had found someone else to help me do the dishes. Having courted lovingly for a year, Ian decided to propose, to ask for Vivien's hand in marriage, because she was the one he had chose. In December they became engaged, a party we all had. It was all recorded in video. The filmmaker was Ian's dad. The festivities being over, the wedding plans were made. The date was fixed, the hotel was booked, and I'm glad that we had saved. Our house has been going like a fair. And I really am amazed how together Vivien and her mum, all these lovely favours they have made. The family all decided it was a kilt that I should wear. They didn't seem to stop and think that folk would stand and stare. But for this lovely kilty outfit, it's Doogie and Sheena I must thank. Because in spite of my old knobbly knees, they've made me look a real swank. But what about another kilty? Our wee nephew Craig. Didn't he look very smart, dressed up as Vivien's page? I've seen that kilt before, although it's rather a wee one, because about 20 years ago it was worn by Big Ian. Now Vivien and Ian decided to buy a house, one which they could afford, an 8-floor flat in Cumbernauld, which both of them adore. It's been papered, it's been painted, it's been scrubbed till it is clean. And now their little palace is fit even for the Queen. And now the day it has arrived when Vivien and Ian are married. And when they return from their honeymoon, over the threshold she'll be carried. To start their married life together in their own wee button bed, health, happiness and prosperity is what we wish for them. So please be on your feet and raise your glass and drink a beer toast to Vivien and to Iain, the couple we love the most. Ladies and gentlemen, Vivien and Iain, good health, happiness, and God bless you. Vivien and Iain.
A most excellent and well-prepared speech indeed. In fact, I'm awfully glad that there's a day between now and Sunday to give me a chance to prepare something for me. Iain, I don't know you as well as I know Vivien, naturally, but I've come to know you these last few months, and I can't help but remark it's been nice to see Iain coming to Denny Old Parish Church on a Sunday leading up to his marriage. Okay, he's done a wee bit of courting in the back seat. At least the young laddie has shown his love for the kirk along with his love for his bonnie bride. Iain, as any married man here will tell you, it's most appropriate that you should be married today in a kilt. Because, as any married man here will tell you, you'll never get a chance to wear the trousers again. Now, Iain, this is the only chance you'll ever get in married life to actually stand up and speak out and say exactly what you want. So, Iain, I just hope you can read Vivien's writing. It's all right.
On behalf of my wife and I, I just thank you all very much for being here today. Thank you very much for your very kind presence and your good wishes. I'd like to start by thanking this woman, Dad, very much for the wedding today, especially to this Dad for always helping to decorate and helping to do the wallpaper. I did two sheets of it. I'd like to thank both my mum and dad for their support in the past. I'd like to thank Q here for being my best man, making sure I didn't run away today. The ushers, Gordon, Graham, Grant and Iain. And I'd like to thank Mr. Smith very much for that moving service today. So much so we're moving to Cumbernauld.
Indeed, Iain, for a most able speech. It's amazing you haven't shown any signs of nerves since you left the vestry this afternoon, Iain. Well done. I mentioned about Iain coming to the church, and it reminded me about the minister who was asked to do an evening service in a country parish, and this solitary old lady in the congregation, she fainted when he gave out his text from Genesis. I shall wrestle with thee until the break of dawn. Or do you hear about the two Chelsea pensioners sitting in the park bench, and old Andrew turns to old Willie and says, "Willie, do you mind during the Boer War to put stuff in your tea to take your minds off the lasses?" And the other pal took his pipe out of his mouth and says, oh, now that you mention it, now that you mention it, I mind finding a bit of stuff in your tea to take our minds off it, the lasses. Ah, well, says Andrew, I think mine's is starting to take effect. I now call upon Hugh to read the cards at the telegrams and maybe tell us some home truths about Iain in your speech.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. Well, Iain, on behalf of Jennifer and Harry, I'd like to thank you very much for posing the toast to our lovely bridesmaids. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to read a few messages of congratulations that arrived today for Iain and Vivien. I'd just like to read the ones from those who can't be with us tonight. This is with our good wishes for your future together, Edna and Jock Stalker. And this is to Iain and Vivien, best wishes from all of us. Jacqueline and Philip. All the very best for the future to you both. Love from Lisa. From Johnson and Dorothy. Congratulations from Jim and Bunty family. Best wishes, Dot and Tennessee. Still awake? All our love to you both. Lots of love from Uncle Stuart and Aunt Audrey. I'm sorry we can't be here with you today, but it sounds like lovely luggage instead. Congratulations and best wishes, David and Sheena Jarvis. All the very best wishes for a great day and a happy future together. Love from Janet and Martin. Love and good wishes to you both, Cecilia, yours. Ivan and Rena Paul. Grant and Grandma Shepherd, love and best wishes. All the best for the future, lots of love from Emily and James. Here's again, love from John Bethany. To Vivien and Iain, the very best wishes for your future happiness, love, Joyce and Richard Taylor. To Iain and Vivien, congratulations from all the staff of Thomas Cotton and Sons. Congratulations and bless you both, Robert and Phyllis Shanks. Here's another one from Warwick and Alec Poole family. Just one late arrival here. It's, we hope you both have a fun-filled and action-packed honeymoon from the management staff of Hugo Tours. By opening up the cupboard from his past and letting all the skeletons out. But he has pleaded, nay, begged of me the last few months not to say anything. As a man of honour, I never go back in the general bride. So I'd really like to make a few comments about how this all started. It's almost 3 years ago, Iain and Vivien met through mutual friends while Vivien was studying in Edinburgh. He was invited through to a party, and during the evening, the eyes met across the floor. That's where it all started. The scene was set for the very first date. Now, both being fans of the singer and actor Phil Collins, they decided for the first date to go and see his latest film, Buster. Now, you would have been very proud of Iain, because there he was, hair combed to perfection, designer blazer, silk tie, both of which I'm still waiting for back here, and he headed off to the Far East. But disaster struck, and Iain got stuck. Very heavy traffic in the outskirts of Edinburgh. He was about 40 minutes late. He was Vivien standing outside the cinema thinking, stood up again. But Iain eventually arrived and they saw the last half of the film. And to this day, this is still been the greatest unfulfilled part of the relationship. And I'm very pleased to say tonight's the night. Both of you will eventually be able to see the film you've never
about that.
The video shot wanted it back from 9 o'clock. I get it back from 9 o'clock. What's impressed me most about being a fan is that openness and honesty with each other, which in today's society really is quite remarkable. They have no secrets at all from each other. They told each other about all the past, even confessed to Vivien about all his previous loves, and how it paled into insignificance beside Vivien. In turn, Vivien told Iain all about her past. She told Iain she was only 16, yes, just 16, when she had her very first home. But sadly, only a few months later, her other leg went the same way. Scots law, that was quite sufficient. I recalled a few years ago how the young groom picked up the pen and signed the schedule with two X's. It didn't surprise Mr. Smith, who couldn't see any reason for using two X's when one would be sufficient. And later in the evening, in a quieter moment, he took the groom aside and asked him to explain this. And quite embarrassed, the groom said, "Well, I'm sorry, Mr. Smith, I'll never be able to write even one name." He said, "Well, that's quite understandable. I see the reason for that, but one X was done. Why a second X?" And quite indignantly said, "That's from my HND computing from the fuck up." Sentiments Iain has in his heart for you, and I have the courage to make on his behalf tonight. To see her is to love her. Love but her forever. For nature made her what she is, and never made another. Vivien, God bless you.
Thank you very much indeed, Hugh. You made a wonderful job of your speech, an excellent speech indeed. The story told about three wee girls in the school playground talking about the day they would be married, and the first wee girl said, "When I'm big, I'll marry a teacher, then, I'll marry an artist, then I'll be good at art." The second one said, "When I'm big, I'll marry a musician, then I'll be good at music." The third wee girl thought for a wee while, then she says, "When I'm big, I will marry a minister, then I'll be good for nothing." I now call upon Dougie, Iain's dad, to say a few words. It's all yours, Iain. Dougie.
Thank you very much. Well, Iain, you're well and truly Cooper now, sir. This is a very happy day for Sheena and I. We're absolutely delighted at this marriage. But it's also a sad day when your younger son leaves home and we are going to miss him greatly. Mostly for the things that he does, the way he fixes things electrical and mechanical. But it wasn't always that way, because as a young boy, he came from a broken home. Broke most of it. Tricycles, large metal lorries, Iain reduced to scrapped in a couple of days. And it's unbelievable. The stories about our Iain are a legion. He had a very inquiring mind, and it was always daddy, followed by a question, interminable questions. And one day, I came home from work after a pretty bad day, and he started up one question after the other, daddy, daddy. Finally, I picked it up, and I walked through the bathroom, not realizing he was padding along behind me. As I put my hand in the bathroom door, the boy said, daddy. And under my breath, I said, he said, all right, if you're going to say Christ, I won't bother. Another time, the boys used to come in a Sunday morning early and come into bed with Shane and myself. And one sorry. He was sitting astride me and he pointed to the tummy button and he said, what's that for? And believing that children should be told the truth, I explained to them about their umbilical cord, etc. And I listened to him passively. And then he said, all right, now tell me the truth. Well, actually, Ian, when you're eating a fish supper in bed, that's where he puts off. But his crowning one was, one night we had company in, and Ian appears at the steps into the lounge, hanging on to the thing at the side, and he said, Mummy, what's rape? And Sheena replied without hesitation, that is when a man attacks a lady. Oh, said Ian. And what is it when a lady attacks a man? She said, that's luck, son. Ian, thank you just for being here. It's my pleasure and duty to welcome Viv into the Gillis family. She joins a long line of accomplished women who are fortunate. And Viv is an accomplished young woman. She has a B, D, oh sorry, C, E, that's a Freudian slip. She can turn her hand to many things, her art, etc., calligraphy. And this young couple will work for nothing, because if Viv can't knit it, she can manufacture it from whole egg boxes and toilet rolls. Viv, or should I say, Mrs. Iain Gillis, welcome most sincerely to the Gillis family.
Thank you very much again for the sincerity of your speech, all the speeches have been most sincere and yet full of humour and truth and a nice touch throughout them all. So well done, gents. And now, as we live in a modern day when it's equal rights, I now call upon the ladies to stand up and turn and make their speeches. Seriously, ladies and gentlemen, it is a joy and a pleasure for all of us to share in this happy day of the wedding of Vivien and Iain. It's a joy to be included in their family celebrations. It's up to us now, the tone has been set, the standard set, to enjoy the rest of the evening and be like myself and let your hair down. It's not easy, it's not hard at all. And enjoy the dancing and the fellowship. And